Okay. Can everybody hear me okay? We're good? We're going to let them pass out coffees and feel free to finish your dessert, but we're going to go ahead and get started tonight. So thank you for all the help we've had tonight. Y'all have been great. All right, well, once again, thank you so much for being here tonight. This is a special, special night for us. I was thinking the other day that, you send your son off to Clemson, and there's a pretty good chance. Oh, could we get this music off somehow? Perfect, thank you. Is that better? All right. Y'all might enjoy the music more than you enjoy me talking, but once again, welcome tonight to this rehearsal dinner. What I was saying was that it's really, you send your son off to Clemson, and this is the second one for us. There's a really good chance that, they're going to meet a girl from the Carolinas. So we now have South Carolina with Mary Beth and North Carolina with Margaret, but that's a good thing, and so we're very excited about that. I want to say, first of all, I want to say thank you to Keith and Eileen. This has been wonderful. We're day number two. We had fun last night at a welcome party and got to meet so many of your friends, and some of you I see were here last night, and we really enjoyed that time, so that was a good way to kick things off. I know tomorrow is the big event, so we got a little taste today of the venue, so we got a treat ahead. So we're very excited, and we're going to pray for great weather, and some cloud cover will be helpful. So it's going to be great. So tonight's a unique night. Recently, I was talking to a young friend of mine that comes to our house on a regular basis with some couples, and we were talking about this night and rehearsal dinners, and he said, it's really a special time because you don't have many venues when you're able to have this many people and to be able to share and celebrate, two people. And so it's kind of if you think about it, it's a very unique setting to do this. You may say things in private, but this is a unique time, and we're thankful for it. I've thought a lot about tonight about sort of reflected back on some things with Reed and recently with Margaret. And I think that anyone in this room that has, if you've got one child, especially if you have multiple kids, you realize that each of your kids is so unique and different. God's designed and wired them each incredibly unique. And their personality, their temperament, interests, their abilities, and their skills are all so different. And that's certainly the case with us for, with Reed. Alice and I can both honestly say that Reed was honestly a joy to raise. And that's not, I think almost at times we'd think of in terms of being sort of on autopilot, sort of cruising through life. Maybe that's the third child piece of it. I don't know, but we are super proud of you, buddy, and it was just incredibly fun to kind of have him on this journey. So some of the things that come to mind when I think about Reed, Reed was always a compliant kid, teachable. He was a focused, determined person that a great brother to, Connor and to Josh. His interests were broad in terms of his skills and talents, and whether it was sports, whether it was music, whether it was reading, longboarding with some of these guys, from video work with friends in high school, and we could always, as life went on, we could count on Reed and even to Josh some extent to keep us kind of updated on our Spotify music list to make sure we were semi-current.
But as you know, as Reed got older and in high school and in college years, so the way I thought about him was that his maturity seemed to be a little bit more beyond what his age was, and that was my. I always would think of him as a dad. As it, you know, he's a deep guy, and he I think he valued deep friendships. There's a couple guys here from high school tonight. There's plenty of you guys from Clemson. I think that had some really close friendships with Reed, and so I think that was something that was very important to him. And I think spiritually, he loved to dig into Scripture. There was deeper books, a lot of theological deep books he would enjoy reading. So those are some perceptions of some things that I thought about when I think about Reed. A number of years ago, another one of my sons and I went to a father-son camp in California, and so one of the afternoon routines that the dads would go through would be to. We would have a lakeside chat where we'd talk about, raising children. And one of the, it was called a journey to transition. And so one of the, there was a large mural that was behind. And so the scene you would have from that was, on the left-hand side was a beach scene with parents playing with their children. And then you'd progress out to the water. And the water was, it would get, deeper and deeper, obviously, as you got the ocean. And so, but the idea was, and then at the far right side was a buoy and a sailboat heading out toward Independence. And so through that process, obviously the focus was on, from the standpoint of a dad, the role of a caretaker, and you became a cop, a coach, and then ultimately, you move to the role of more of a consultant type role, and which is where you find your kids when as they age and get older, and so I think obviously the goal is for one day for whoever had sons or daughters there to be at that point where we are tonight, where you can sort of that journey from being a kid and to getting married and having an independent life, and so there's a lot of great memories and. But as I was thinking about tonight of what to talk about, I guess what struck me was that pattern and that journey, there's a lot of things that happen along that route. And so, the timing of that path and how it works for each kid can differ a whole lot. But as parents, and Alice and I, like probably many of you here, there's so many things that you want and desire for your kids when they're growing up. Obviously you want them from a... You want them healthy. You want, successful, whatever that you conjured that up to be, whether it's in school or athletics or whatever they're doing. And Reed was no exception. And there were many, there were many things that we would pray about for him and guide him on. But, first and foremost on that list was a prayer that, that God would draw Reed to himself, that there would be, there would be that point in time when God would open his eyes this is not part of tonight, I promise you. I apologize. That God would open his eyes to see and hear the gospel truth, and that Reed would have that true saving faith. And I think that, as our pastor talks about so much, is that, there's that root, and then you'll see a shoot, and then there's a fruit. And I think that the prayer was is that that one day that they would be in him, that spiritual root, which from Christ's finished work and then Reed trusting in faith in him, and then you'd begin to see the evidence of that play out in his life. And so, God answered that prayer, and we begin to see that evidence. None of that said to boast one single thing about Reed or boast nothing about us as parents, none of it. It's all about the fact that I think Alice and I would say that, you know, just that journey, just we approach this with thankfulness and gratitude for God for what he's done. And it's as simple as that. And I'm sorry for getting choked up, but it was not part of it tonight. So I think when I look back on that transition, and I think about sort of the process, you picture back on the beach to the sailboat. I think, you know, the way I look at this is that there's, Allison, I think we can say that we were part of that journey. And one thing that's so cool is that when I look around this room, at many of these in this room, and I think about that there's so many people and there's so many places and there's so many situations that that make up that. And so I can think of junior high and high school friends. There's a couple guys here tonight, you know, Connor and Banks, just to name two guys from high school, that, you know, friends that, you know, were chosen and now they're working together and are maintain great friendships. And see these guys get married young. And I see, I remember various junior high and high school teachers. There's coaches, there's teachers, there may be Bible teachers along the way or whoever that had some bit of influence and impact at various times I know in Reed's life. I can think of youth pastors, and I can think of other leaders at church. I can think of summer youth camps. I can think of these Clemson friends. I can think of, you know, you walk into campus really not knowing a soul. Connor went to Clemson, but he's 6 years older, and so those friendships were no longer really there. And to be able to meet some of these guys and do some of the things that were, you know, guys that wanted to dig deep and share life with, that's really cool. And I think it's something that we're so appreciative of. You know, things like FCA, Clemson, Margaret get involved in something like Young Life, and other guys are involved in Young Life. And see that happen is really, really special. You know, working in Missouri at a summer camp, working in Charlotte at a summer camp, all those things, sort of stepping outside the comfort zone to serve and do things. And so I look back, and there's a lot of people, a lot of touches along the way. So when I think of that transition, it's not the foundation I mentioned earlier, but then it's you know, hopefully Alice and I have done a pretty good job, but there's a lot of people that have been involved in this process. Margaret. First time I met Margaret was October of 2017, and I remember we had a bunch of, and some of you, I know there's a lot of guys in this room that were there, and we used to rent lake houses at Clemson sometime and have all the friends come up, and I remember sitting at a table with her, it was a couple of the girls, we started talking, and we had some conversation about Charlotte and going up there. And so I remember later when I knew they were serious about some things, I thought, you know, I feel like I had a little bit of connectivity at that point. So that was kind of special to me. So we have, we so enjoyed, you know, the times we had. And there was a few years we got to come to Clemson and visit. And Reed and Margaret became a regular part of our visits there, which was so, so fun for us. I think a real unexpected blessing was last summer when Margaret moved to Birmingham, and that was really something that we did not anticipate, and so having her in town and being able to do some things with them together, whether it's after church, whether it's just pop by the house, whatever, has been really a neat time for us. Margaret's already become a great aunt to Hayes, our little grandson. And so that's been fun to watch all that. But Margaret, we love your quiet and gentle spirit. We so admire you we love your work and what you do there. I know you have a passion for that. So it's fun to kind of watch that from the side. So we're really happy and so happy for both of you guys together and are thrilled about what's about to take place. Jason Ellerby's here tonight from our church, and he'll lead the service tomorrow. But Jason is the young couple's pastor at our church, and Alice and I, a number of years ago, began to have young couples in our home each week, and so we would host just as a host home, and maybe we'd have some time of fellowship as an extension of our church. And so all these couples are newly married like this. Some of them we'll get to see, some might have their first baby or something, and before they may roll somewhere else. But it's a really we love this age, and we love kind of maybe we can be impacted, used somehow to mentor and work with them. But there are several things I've kind of observed from some of these couples is that, you know, individually or together, they have such a strong desire to grow in their faith. And you can just, it's evidence in them. You know, church and small group is super important to them. You know, they like a place that, you know, which I guess is our house, or there's a lot of houses that do this. You know, they can walk through and study something or grow or have some accountability and pray together. So that's really a neat time. And there's one, there's a little devotional that I like. It's by a London minister, and there's a little, one of the days in there is entitled, Get the Center Right. And he uses Matthew 6:33, and which about seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And this is what it says. He says, it's all about the center. Get the center right, says the world's greatest teacher, and the rest will fit in. Let Jesus and his word act as a rudder for the start of every day. So my prayer and encouragement for you guys, and it's been fun to sort of see you begin some of this, your time in Birmingham, is to keep getting that center right, individually and as a married couple. We've enjoyed watching that, and from the involvement we've had a little bit here and there. And then my one final thought is I learned a number of years ago from my father-in-law that, and he was one of the first people that I heard that would talk about generational thinking. And I never heard that really much before, but I guess having three sons, having one daughter-in-law, but having another daughter-in-law, having a grandson, you begin to see that fleshed out. And so it's special for us to be able to kind of watch the next generations unfold, and to see that all happen. And so we're thrilled about all that, and we're excited for you guys, and glad that we could we can and continue to be a part of this journey a little bit. So congratulations. I'm sorry for the few tears today, but it was not anticipated. So, okay. So that's my portion. And I want to, I'm going to pull this podium back, and I'm going to put this mic over here. And you guys are welcome. Anybody that wanted to come and share and talk, the mic's yours. And we will... I do know there's a big football game tonight, so we're aware of all that, and so I'm fully clear with that. So and I know the Rublins are having a wonderful party for many of you at their house afterwards, and so just know that's all happening, and it's all going to be good. So I'm gonna pull this back, and you're welcome to come up here if you'd like to share some things with Morgan.
This on here. Hey guys, I'm Josh. I'm Reed's older brother, second oldest brother, I guess. I'm just gonna talk without the microphone. So thanks for inviting me, Reed. Appreciate it. No, but Mark, you're great. You're so beautiful on the outside, but more importantly, you've such a sweetheart. I've enjoyed getting to know you. I'm super glad you're living in Birmingham. You'd be close to me. I'm super excited for you to be in our family. Reed, I love you, man. I have really, really appreciated our recent conversations. You mean more to me than you know. The most important relationship in your life is your relationship with God.
and that is evident in everything that you do. And, you know, the things of this world are just so small, and you really understand that, and you understand, like, the glory of what's to come. And, man, I just respect that in you. I really do. And yeah, man, I look forward to just hanging out with y'all. Maybe we can get, like, UAB season tickets or something. But anyways, I love you guys a lot. Thank you.
All right. So I'm Connor. I'm Ray's oldest brother. I guess we figured we'd just get the brothers out of the way early on. So yeah, I mean, I echo a lot of stuff Josh just said. Starting with Reed, I mean, all the great conversations we've had over the years, just hanging out. Now that we're Mary Beth and Hayes and I are back in Birmingham, being able to, you know, play basketball, see you and Mar more often has been awesome, and it will be great once y'all are married, and we're just looking forward to hanging out more and more. It's fun to share the Clemson experience and have a lot of great memories doing that. Mar, I'm going to call you Mar. No, I'll be with Margaret. Mar, it's been great getting to know you. I know I echo what Mary Beth would say as well, is that we've had a great experience getting to know you, and it's just been a lot of fun hanging out with you in Birmingham, and we're just looking forward to, you know, you being around Hayes and our family, and us just all hanging out over the years. So what I want to say, I wrote down a few things, just some encouragement for y'all as y'all get married tomorrow, and then just for everyone else in the room who is married or who desires to be married, just a few thoughts that I had and I wanted to share. So I'm a big fan of John Piper, the pastor. Used to be a pastor in Minneapolis, and he has this, he coined this phrase called Christian hedonism. It's all about joy and where joy is found. And he has a phrase, or Christian hedonism, the way he defines it is, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. So it's all about where we find our joy. Our joy is ultimately found in Christ. And then in marriage, he has another little phrase that he mentions in an article that I wanted to read that kind of goes hand in hand with finding our joy in Christ and finding joy in your spouse. It says, the reason there's so much misery in marriage is not that husbands and wives seek their own pleasure, but that they do not seek it in the pleasure of their spouses. The biblical mandate to husbands and wives is to seek your own joy in the joy of your spouse. So just encouragement to y'all, Mary Beth and I, we've been married for 7 years, and then for everyone else who is married, just as you find your joy in Christ, you know, seek joy in Christ through the joy in each other, and then your spouse in your future marriage, and you'll find more of him and enjoy marriage and continue to be able to develop a relationship with Christ, which will have fruit in every area of your life. So we're excited for y'all, Mary Beth and Hayes and I. We're so glad that y'all are in Birmingham, excited about tomorrow, and it's just been a great weekend. So that's it.
Hello, can you? Okay, I feel like I'm gonna use the microphone just in case. Hi, everyone. I'm Lindsay, Margaret's sister, and I'm gonna be looking at my phone mostly because I'm nervous and also because I think it will help me not cry. And I'm a very sympathetic crier, so if I see any tears, especially you, I will cry. So I just wanted to take a moment to brag on Mar, because if you know Mar, you know she's always bragging on me. So we've always been so close. In fact, we are 17 months apart, so very close. And she's actually older, but a lot of people wouldn't know that. People, when we were younger, were always saying, I looked older. Restaurants, you might see the waiter putting a wine glass in front of my plate in the kids 12 and under menu in front of Margaret. Sorry, Mar, I'm sure you absolutely loved that, but she is older, and thank goodness for that. Am I talking really loud? Oh, you were saying so. And thank goodness for that. Needed you as an older sister when I'm pulling this up. Sorry, I'm getting nervous, and so I'm forgetting where I was. But anyways, Mar, there's a whole lot of things that I'm grateful for you for. And I think one of the main things is you being the first at everything. And honestly, it came in handy for me and worked in my favor. Walking into class, the teachers would look at me with like a smile and like a sigh of relief. Oh, you must be Margaret's sister. It always helped with first impressions. And you were always so patient, especially with me and with Drew and Will and just everybody. But having you being the first for everything, being the first to go to high school and college and the real world, like you were always there. You were my voice of reason, my calming presence. You were the one giving me advice. And though she would never admit it, she is the perfect child, as I would call the angel child. You wouldn't admit it, but it's true. She was the one that you wanted your kid to play with on the playground. You were like, once you told your kid at home, oh, I wish you could just be like Margaret Roblin. It's true. And even though being the perfect child, you know, highlighted some of my own flaws, which it did, it was never something where I felt like I could never live up to you. It was always something where I'm like, you make me want to be the, and it's cheesy. You know, I'm not cheesy. Sorry. You're crying, excuse me. Anyways. Sorry, but stop looking at me because you're crying. I'm kidding. But anyways, you being the older sister, never felt like I couldn't live up to you. It was always like you made me want to be the best version. I said I wasn't gonna cry, and I'm crying of myself. So, to the person who always makes everyone else feel so loved and special, I hope you feel like that this weekend, and I'm so happy for both of y'all and excited for y'all, and I'm crying, and this is so embarrassing, but I'm so happy for y'all, so I love you both, and I hope you have the best weekend, and I'm so excited to celebrate you tomorrow.
Hi everyone, I'm Molly. I'm one of Mara's friends from college and one of her bridesmaids. Mara and I first met when we moved into Manning Hall freshman year, and we knew we were going to be friends right away. All throughout recruitment and rush, we always talked about how we wanted to be sisters, and on bid day, we almost fell flat on our faces running down because we refused to let go of each other's hands running down to everyone on bid day. This began the next 3 years of us living together. And I guess technically we didn't live together freshman year, but as Sarah Burke can attest, I basically lived in their dorm room that year as well. The next 2 years, people would always joke that it was like Mara and I were dating. This was before Reed. We had many nights eating stir fry at Schletter and brushing our teeth together in Manning, and we would even bring a speaker into the showers with us at our dorm room, so we could be in separate stalls but sing to the same songs while we showered. We would always make sure our dresses and dates were coordinated for functions so we could be buddies. Even one function, much to my date's surprise, I started crying on the walk over there because I just love Mar so much. one of my favorite texts to receive all throughout college was a quick checking in text from Mar, always so thoughtful and wanting to make sure I was having a good day. Mar and I also studied abroad together in Spain, and we joked that after our classes ended, we went on a little honeymoon, just the two of us. Our favorite spot was a little fishing village in Italy, and one day we walked over into a neighboring village and sat down at dinner. And we were next to this cute couple from Iowa, so we started chatting with them because we were like, oh, thank goodness, other Americans. And the husband of the pair goes, oh, do you guys have boyfriends at home? And his wife kicked him under the table and was like, you can't ask that. And we were like, oh my gosh, no, we're not together. And Mar Mark and tell them about her lovely boyfriend, Reed, who is back in the States. Since I started at Clemson, Mar has been my closest friend. Even now we live 750 miles apart instead of 2 feet. We always pick up right where we left off. You are loving, kind, intelligent, and loyal. You're an amazing listener, and you have shown me unconditional love and compassion, highs and my lows. And like Lindsay said, you have always been the type of person that makes me want to be the best version of myself. I love you. I remember when Mar walked into my dorm room sophomore year and told me about forgetting her phone in Reed's car as an excuse to ride back up to the parking lot with him to have some extra time to chat with him. Very soon after that, I was helping her pick out her outfit for their first date. Mar was convinced after Reed asked her out that they were going to the dining hall for breakfast. I was like, I will bet you anything he's not taking you to the dining hall. And she still owes me for that bet because Reed did not take her to the dining hall on their first date. I can't believe that was almost 3.5 years ago. And I'm so excited for you both as you move into this new phase. And I'm so excited to cheer for your love for forever.
Hello. Hey, everybody. I'm Sam, and I had the pleasure of living with Reed for the last 3 years. Not the last 3 years, but 3 years at Clemson. It was a great experience. I want to take this time just to give Mar a little heads up about what it can be like to share a room with Reed. It can be pretty interesting. So, to start things off, I don't know if it was the first night. It was one of the first nights that me and Reed ever shared a room together, and Reed, I'm a night owl. I stay up kind of late. So Reed had been asleep for a little while. I go to get in bed, and I walk into the room, and I'm like getting ready for bed. And Reed has been asleep, granted, for 2 hours probably. And all of a sudden, I hear Reed. He yells at me. He says, "Sam, watch out!" And I was like, "What?" I was like, "What's happening?" And I turn around. I look at him. I said, "What are you talking about?" He points up at the fan. He said, "The fan's about to fall on you." And I look up, and the fan is spinning like normal. Nothing's wrong with it. And I was like, "What are you talking about?" And he goes, "Dude, heads up. The fan's about to cut you." And I look up. The fan's fine. And I turn around and look at Reed, and I was like, "Dude, what are you talking about?" And literally, he's completely dead asleep. Nothing happens for us tonight. I was like, "All right, whatever." I was like, "First night, I'm just going to ignore it. Act like nothing happens." So that was a good start to our sharing a room together. Probably 2 nights later, I go to bed. I'm laying there. And I've probably been in bed for about 10 minutes, and I hadn't fallen asleep yet, and I'm facing the wall. All of a sudden, I feel someone grab my leg, and I freak out. I roll over, and I look up, and Reed's just standing over me. And I look at him, I'm like, "What?" And he just stands there looking at me, doesn't say anything. I was like, "Reed, what are you doing?" And he goes, "I don't know." I said, "Why'd you grab my leg?" And he goes, "I'm sorry, I don't know." And he goes and gets back in bed. And I was like, "All right, man, this guy, he's kind of weird to share a room with." And then, so that's 2 times, probably the first week and a half, 2 weeks. And then a few weeks later, I'm sitting there in bed. This time I had fallen asleep, probably 3 in the morning. And I've been asleep for a while. All of a sudden I hear this loud crash. And I roll over and I look, and he's standing in the middle of our room. And his chest of drawers on the ground. He had grabbed the top of the chest of drawers and he threw it on the ground, and he's standing there and he's just looking at it. And I said, "Reed, why did you throw your chest of drawers over?" And he said, "I don't know." And I was like, "Bro, what is wrong with you?" And he didn't really answer, and he just kind of slowly walked back in bed and crawled in, pulled the covers over him, and went back to sleep. I was like, "All right, this guy, he's got some issues." So, granted, other than that, there's nothing big. I heard him talking to sleep a few times. He would have some interesting dreams where he would say weird stuff, whatever. I just kind of ignored it because that was nothing compared to all of those stories. But granted, sharing a room with Reed and just living with him for the past 3 years was such a blessing. And it really was great just to have a good friend like him who was he was always there to support me. You know, Reed's the kind of guy who he loves when you can just sit down and ask him questions. That's completely a joke. If you don't know Reed, he kind of hates that. But granted, even if he doesn't love that, he's a great friend. And he's somebody who, you know, he made my 4 years at Clemson better. And I'm super thankful for him. And I think that, you know, the rest of these guys here that live with him and were around him a lot can attest to it. And really, I would say until my senior year, me and Mara didn't spend a lot of time together. But after that, it was really awesome to get to spend some time with Mara, and I think we became a lot closer over the last year. So it really is just a blessing to get to spend life with y'all, and I'm super excited to see what the next few years hold. So super thankful for y'all, and love y'all both. Thank y'all.
Hey everybody, I'm Josh. I am also a Clemson friend. Met Reed probably like 2 or 3 days in. We went and played basketball. We had a good group of 5 guys, went and played basketball. Reed was a great basketball player, except for the wide open layups. Couldn't seem to get a hold of those. But besides that, great tall athlete. But we had a lot of great memories, as Sam was talking about. Honestly, the sleepwalking memories of Reed is one of my favorite, and of him eating food very quickly, or just there's a lot of fun memories to talk about with Reed. But this past year, I've actually had some great memories with Reed, even though he's in Birmingham and I'm in Charlotte. We got COVID at the same time with our friend Bo Sluder, which we ended up having a great time. We're very grateful that we didn't feel it bad, and we had 14 days of us three staying at my house and making sushi that we had to eat like a burrito because we couldn't cut it, or just playing Mario Kart. I mean, literally spent all day, every day together, couldn't really go anywhere. But it was still so much fun to be with Reed, and just he's just an easy guy to be around. And then this past week, he got to come out to Charlotte and hang out with us for a few days before he got married. And there's something about Reed where he's just so comfortable and confident in himself that it's just so refreshing. It's there's no pressure, and it makes it easy for me to not to just be who I am, and I really appreciate that, Reed. I don't really know what that is, but I just feel like whenever I'm around you, I can be who I am and not have to worry about I don't know. It's just easy, and there's no pressure, and so that's been really refreshing to be around. And Mar's awesome, as everybody knows, and as we've talked about. And there's something when Mar and Reed are around each other, they just are so happy, honestly. They're just so smiley and giggly, and they just do their own thing in the side. Everyone's hanging out, and they're just smiling in their own corner or whatever. and so that's been really fun to watch. And so I'm excited for y'all to get to spend the rest of y'all's life together. So cheers to Reed and Mar. I love y'all both.
I'm going to try and use this because I'm not very loud. But my name's Anna. I have the privilege of being one of Mar's closest friends. And I know Reed, too, even before Mar, which makes this really special. I think I have the self-proclaimed title of being Mar's best friend until Reed came along. And then now Reed gets that title, and I think he is the only person I would give it up for. You know, there's been funny stories about Mar and Reed. I think Molly mentioned this story about her phone. But the cool thing about being Mar's best friend is I've had a very close snapshot into Mar and Reed's relationship, and sometimes I can honestly say that I know way too much. And so instead of storing all of that up for myself, I'm going to tell all of you some really fun stories about Mar and Reed that I'm sure most of you don't know. So it all starts at the beginning when Margaret Roblin asked me for Reed Hodges' number. Which in itself is kind of funny, because me and Reed were actually not that close of friends. But Mar texts me one day. She's like, hey, can you send me Reed's number? And I was like, sure, no big deal. Like, all of us are big friends at Clemson, so I didn't think anything of it. And later that day, I was sitting down with her, and I was like, hey, Mar, like, why did you ask me for Reed's number? Like, why didn't you ask someone else? And before I could even get to the end of my sentence, Mar screams, no, Anna, I don't like Reed. And I was like, oh, I didn't think you did, but now I totally am on to you. And so a few weeks later, this next story comes about, and it's the story of how Reed asked Mar on their first date. So Reed would kind of linger around Mar every now and then. He was like looking to shoot a shot, couldn't find the right moment. And so Reed picked Margaret and one of our friends up from our parking lot. We had a really far walk to our dorm. And if you know Margaret, she's the most mild, meek, not gonna like go jump off a cliff kind of boldness. Like, it's the thing I love the most about her. So she doesn't do extreme things. It's very rare. And so she said Reed had like circled around behind her car to pick her up. And she sat there just staring at her cell phone for like 30 seconds. And she thought, I have an idea. And so she chunks her phone in the back of her car and gets out of the car and goes and gets in the car with Reed. And so he pulls her and our friend up to our dorm to drop her off. And Mar's like, man, I left my phone in my car. What am I going to do about that? And Reed so earnestly is like, I'll take you, no questions. And so that, on the way home from that drive, is when Reed asked Margaret on a date. And he kept telling her, I was looking for a shot to get you by yourself to ask you out, and I couldn't. And that gave me the prime opportunity. So really, you set yourself up very well. And I think a question I get a lot about Mar and Reed is, when did you know? Like, when did you know Reed was the one, so you call it, even though y'all hate that term, but when did you know Reed was going to be the guy for Mar? And I really look at it, and I think there's two very specific moments, and they both deal with your families, which I love the most. And so the first moment I knew was after Reed took Mar home to Birmingham for the weekend, and Mar comes back and sits on my dorm floor, and for like 3 hours, she just talks about Reed and how happy he was to have her in Birmingham. And she had so much fun with him, and like Reed was the most fun. She had the best time in Birmingham. And seeing her talk about Reed for hours, I was like, oh, this guy's going to stick around. Like, he's not going anywhere. And the second time was on their birthday. So their birthdays are really close together, which is going to make it really fun for y'all. And so the Roblins came into town. They took us all out to dinner. And it was, you know, Mr. Roblin, Mar, and then Reed. They were all chatting. We were all nervous for Reed to finally meet the family. And me and Miss Roblin sat in the corner like schoolgirls chatting about Reed the whole time. And she was like, oh, he's so cute. Isn't he cute? What do you think about Reed? Tell me all about him. And at that moment, Mar was so proud to show Reed off to her family. And I knew he was going to stick around ever since then. But I've had the privilege of being Mar's friend ever since we started Clemson. We're in the same sorority, the same circles. And we've been really close ever since. And I was thinking back in preparation for tonight, what are the things I love the most about Mar? And I was thinking about favorite memories we've had, whether it's going on beach trips or hanging out. And really, better than any memory is the person of who Margaret Roblin is. And when I think about it, there's three things I love the most about Mar. And Reed, it's such a treat because these three things are so evident in who you are too. But the first thing is that Margaret Roblin loves her family, I think, more than anything in this world. In meeting Mar's parents, I was so nervous. I was like, man, if the Roblins don't like me, I'm cut. Like, I'm out of here. And if you know Mar, she loves so deeply that if you love her, you instantly love the people that she loves. And so I was so nervous to meet them. And all I heard about my first year of being friends with her was about both of you and Will and Drew and Lindsay, or Lou. And I didn't know why her name was Lou, but it's your nickname from Mar. But that's all we heard about. And so the thing that's such a treat about that is she loves so deeply that when you have your own family one day, it's going to be her first priority, the thing she pours her life into. And she's had the best example of what that is and what that looks like. And so truly, seeing the way she loves her family makes me know the way I treasure and love my family even more. And so it's my favorite thing about you. The second thing is that Margaret really loves the people around her very deeply because it's evident that she loves the Lord. And she was a Young Life leader for 3 years or 4 years at Clemson. It wasn't easy, but selflessly she gave herself away in a way, making herself better so the people that needed her could be lifted up. And she does it in a way that doesn't need recognition. She doesn't want anyone to know about it. She's the most quiet servant I've ever met. And she's consistently in your corner. But really, my favorite thing was watching Mar fall in love with Reed. He's so consistent and so loyal, and the thing that I learned about Reed through Mar is that you're a fighter. You fight no matter what. You're the most determined person, and the thing about Reed is he doesn't back away from a challenge. He walks straight into the middle of it, and he's so steady, and he is determined that when he walks out of it, it's going to be stronger. And I couldn't think of something better that's evident in both of you for your marriage one day and how successful it'll be. And I'm wrapping up with this, but me and Mar were talking one day about her and Reed. She was so nervous. She loved Reed. She didn't know what's going to happen. They were kind of in that weird in-between with figuring out how serious they were going to be. And she cried to me one day and was like, Reed's just such a gift. I don't want to lose him. And we talked every day about how the Lord really does give us really good gifts each and every day. And our job is not to figure out what those gifts mean. It's not about worrying about how far we can stretch them, afraid that they're not going to be there the next day. But it's to take the gift of today and enjoy it fully, to its full extent, trusting that if the Lord wants us to have that gift tomorrow, he'll give it again to us tomorrow. And after that conversation, I saw her and Reed, their relationship change a lot and grow so much. And when I think about your marriage, that's what I think about, how each day it's going to be the best gift for both of you. And again, the next day, the Lord will give you the gift of marriage again. So my prayer for both of you is that you would walk with that into your marriage and do what you've done the last 3 years and be such a light to everyone around you and such a joy. And I echo what Josh said. When they're in the corner giggling, it kind of makes you uncomfortable. But you learn to love it and hope for that for yourself. So I just want to say good luck to both of you. I love you. And cheers to Reed and Margaret, the future Mr. and Mrs. Hodges.
Hey, my name's Banks. I'm a high school childhood friend of Reed's and have the huge gift of working with Reed full-time. Up until a few months ago, Reed, Connor, and I, and another guy worked in a 12-foot square, so the backs of all of our chairs literally touch as we work. So any moment, my hand can just be on Reed. But you could get in a lot of fights, you could get in a lot of little tussles, but honestly, it was just the best time all getting to work together. So my wife and I recently moved down to Florida, and one of the toughest things has been not being with the other guys in the office. There's a camaraderie there to work hard and get things done. But since we've been down in Florida, there's two highlights that I experience every day. So I'm working from home in a little guest room. Reed knows my little two bunk beds is my backdrop on our video calls. But one is when my wife gets home from work. That's got to be first, best part of my day. But then second is in the morning, a lot of times before Mariel's up, we're already on our computers working, and I'm on the video call, and the first thing, super early, Reed comes up, and it's just a smile. Like, we're just ready to go. He's in the best mood. But honestly, like, I look forward to it every morning. Our Monday mornings, we have early meetings, and it's just a huge blessing. I'm down in Florida kind of alone in this back room, but getting on a video call with Reed and the other guys is just a huge highlight. So I love that. The other thing, when thinking about talking about Reed, a verse came to mind. It's Romans 12:2. It says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect." And the thought about Reed is that he's not just going to stick to the status quo, whatever it is. Reed is going to look most likely to do what's different. He's going to go opposite of what the crowd is doing, but not in a way of being prideful, of just wanting to be different, but wanting to find what's best, wanting to pursue the Lord, be intentional. And it's just been really cool to see through our friendship, through getting to work together. It's just a core value of ours, not to stick to what we think we have to do or what other people are doing around us, but like, let's figure out what's best for us. And let's pursue that. So it's just been really incredible. And then the last thing, that idea of not just sticking to the status quo, but seeing what's best and working your hardest at something and going against the grain. And marriage for y'all. There's a lot of, here's what you need to do, just follow these things and you'll be okay. But it's going to be different for everybody. But Mar, I think the biggest thing with Reed is he's going to be there and figure out what's best in y'all's relationship and put every ounce of effort into that. I've gotten to see that in our work together, and it's been a beautiful, incredible thing. But I look forward to seeing that in y'all's marriage and just being friends for years to come. So cheers to Reed and Mar.
I am Hayden. Been one of Reed's friends for since freshman year now. Met him the first week of school at Clemson. He was one of my first friends I actually met, because from Greenville, so everybody already knew each other. But he was my first out-of-town friend, and one that I've learned to look up to and love since then. I just want to share a few things that I appreciate the most about Reed now, and then why it's okay that Mars is taking him away forever. So first, I love that Reed is a challenger. Just kind of like what Banks was saying, he's not okay with the status quo. There's a lot of times where I would say something that I'd heard somewhere else, just kind of like reflecting something I kind of agree with maybe, that I'd heard from somebody else, and Reed would be like, no, I don't agree with that. That's not right. And I was just like, oh, well maybe you're right. I don't know now. And you're just like, you challenged me to actually think for myself. And I appreciate that. And another thing is, you just think very deeply. I think you're wise well beyond your years. And I would look up to your advice more than I would many people in my life, even people who are much older than me. I just think that just shows the character that you have and the amount that you rely on the Lord, and that you've just developed that relationship with the Lord so well that you can pour into others. I saw that senior year especially, as you were gone from us a lot because you were pouring into FCA so much to love all those people there. And I know they appreciate that so much and learn so much from you. You're a great leader, and I can't wait to see how you lead your family with you and Mar and in the future. And we used to get mad at Reed. He was always the guy that would be gone with Mar. We would all be together and be like, where's Reed? And he's like, oh, he's probably with Mar. Somewhere with Mar. And everybody gets so mad about it, but eventually it didn't make us mad anymore, because it started to be like, well, this is like, that's actually what you're supposed to do. Like, as you fall in love with someone, you should probably like be with them a lot, you know? So the way you love Mar has taught me to love Emily better. And I love you for that. And we got married a couple months ago, so beat you to that. But, you know, I don't have a whole lot of advice for you yet, because, you know, it's been great so far. But I'm just so excited to celebrate y'all. So excited to be here. And I love you like a brother.
Hey, my name is Kira. I'm another one of Mar's closest friends, get the awesome honor to be a bridesmaid. Never been to a wedding before in my adult life, so everything is so new and fun, and people are like, this is how it goes, and I'm like, oh, okay. So it's been super sweet. My favorite thing ever is like watching people like go through like a whole season of their life, like from beginning to end. And so it's been like the coolest to see Mar. I'm already gonna cry. To see Mar like before Reed and then get to know Reed differently. We were all in FCA together, so it was really cool to get to know Reed in a ministry role where we had a relationship, but then also with my best friend Mar. Oh my gosh. Okay, sorry. Transition to something funny. Okay, so. So. Mar and I lived together junior year, and Reed was the best judge of a first date of a boy ever. So I was like, all right, this is perfect. Like, I expected so much of their relationship. It was like the most beautiful like relationship to like see the Lord in people who were like our age. So I was like, all right, perfect. Like, this is like how I'm gonna meet my husband. Like, all right, cool. So I like was on like a co-ed like soccer team with this boy who I had a crush on, and I like messed up my shin or whatever, and we were like talking, and I was like, I just like need to like run to the store to like get like frozen peas for like my shin splint. And he was like, okay. And I was like, so like, but Mar, like, and Reed was like on the bed with Mar, and
they were like, I was like, well, how do I make it like a date? Like, I don't just want to like go to the store to like get frozen peas and like leave. And Reed was like, well, do what I do. Like, we will go to the store and I would be like, well, I need like a toothbrush and I need like a pineapple and like some like toilet paper. And Mara was like, and then it turns into like an hour hangout. And I was like, that's great. So I'm like, me and this boy picking out frozen peas. And I'm like, I'm trying to think. I'm like, what else do I need? And I'm like, no, I think that's it. It's like the fastest date ever. So anyways, but over the years, I've loved getting to know both of them. Their family, too, has been really sweet. So that's been super fun. I had a lot more to say. But basically, I love you both so much. Thank you just for teaching me to love Jesus more and more every day. Thanks for being an amazing example of what a boy looks like who loves Jesus, who gets to love my best friend. So, love you both always. Love, Kiwa.
Hey, I'm Michael. When I was thinking about what I wanted to say, there were two words for Reed that really like popped into my mind. And honestly, kind of funny because there's been so many other words thrown around. And it's like, man, that would have worked too. That would have worked too. But I think that's just a testament to who you are, to how great of a man you are, to how well you love your friends, to how well you love Mar. But the two words, the first one is steadfast. I think kind of like what Josh said, when you walk in your room, like, you just kind of feel good. Like, you just have such a steadfast, steady presence to you. It's commanding, it's just calming. And I really think anyone who is close to you can attest to that feeling that you give them, just of steadiness. And then the other one is pursuant. Pursuant of Mar, pursuant of the Lord, pursuant of your friends. I just think it's clear in this room here, the people that love you, to show, or to see how good your relationship with Mar is, and it's because you pursue her so well, and it's because you pursue the Lord first. And it's an honor to watch that, it's an honor to learn from that. And you're really lucky to be with Mar, and Mar, I think you're really lucky to be with Reed too, so worked out both ways there. But yeah, that's all I wanted to say, but I love you guys a lot.
Hello guys, my name is Connor King and I'm a high school friend as well, and I get the pleasure, just like Banks, being a part of these video calls. And I wanted to start off, the initial memory that I have of mine and Reed's friendship goes back to, we were at scout camp for a week, I think in middle school, and I wasn't the biggest fan of it. Reed was enjoying it a little more than me, but we shared a tent for an entire week. And so we obviously spent a lot of time with each other, an entire week. And then that was in the summer. And then that fall, Clemson played Auburn, maybe like for the first time in a while. And I was there with my dad and brother, and we got tickets in the upper deck, you know, random seats. And then Reed and his dad, and maybe a brother, got tickets as well to the same game. And they were sitting right in front of us the whole game. And we hardly spoke, and so we didn't like connect initially, and so that was after having been with each other for a week. But anyways, we have since become really good friends, and while I was at Auburn, we would catch up really like once every 6 months, and we would always have some great phone calls, and you know, we were just there for each other even though we were so far away. And we would literally wouldn't talk for 6 months, but then we would catch up, and that meant a lot to me for sure. And when I think of of all the things that I could say, there's one that really sticks out, and that is just basically how well you love each other, or well, you do love each other well, but love others is, yeah, you just serve others, and if it means you having to be inconvenienced, you know, you're just inconvenienced to however much you need to be, if that is to love someone else. And so, you know, that's just really a tough thing to do, especially in today's world with how busy everyone is. And, you know, it's tough to just, if you need to give an hour of your time to just do that, but you just always do. And so that really sticks out to me as what will be very beneficial for y'all's marriage, because, I mean, Mar, he'll do whatever you need. And then as well with Mar, you being a nurse, you know, y'all together will just be intense servants on earth. The Bible verse that says that, you know, Jesus came to serve and not to be served, it just is so fitting to me to think that y'all are such good servants on earth, because that is what Jesus did. And so, yeah, happy for y'all. That's it.
Hey everybody, my name is Bud. I got the chance to know Reed the last year of college. I had met Reed at the beginning of college, vaguely remember that. I remember thinking, he's a cool dude, but I couldn't really get that much out of him. And so we became connected in a campus ministry that we were both a part of. And I remember we had a margarita at Habanero's. And we closed out the restaurant, and we had a long conversation, and I was like, man, this guy's great. And from then on, me and Reed just became super close. Some of my greatest conversations in college, I think, were with Reed. That's something about him that I love. I think that all of his best friends can attest to, is that if you know Reed, you've had one great conversation with a guy. He's awesome at that. Another thing that I think of about Reed is his insight. If I'm looking for somebody for wisdom, for thoughtfulness, I call him, and he means a lot to me. Because of him, my faith grew in college, and that's one of the greatest things a friend can give you. And Mar is just kind. Man, she's so great. And so I think their mixture of thoughtfulness, insight, and kindness is going to lead to such a beautiful marriage. And so I'm really happy for them. Love y'all.
Hello, my name is Miles. I met Reed my freshman year, coming to Clemson. It was kind of weird when I met him. It was a FCA small group. At first, the FCA was just like a giant thing, and they're like, sign up for a small group. So I did. A bunch of random people like came to the day. I was like, I really don't want to go meet random people and do that. So, but I like came down to Daniel Square and like knocked on the door. First thing I saw was a Migos poster. I was like, Jesus Christ, what I get myself into? And I was just sitting there. I was like, oh God. But then like Reed was just like, we were going through scripture or whatever. And Reed knows I'm like a pretty tough nut to crack whenever it comes to like talking and especially about anything. So it honestly, like the whole first year, it was just like I come sit down for that hour and then I'm like, I gotta go. So like, I literally like dip out anytime after. He knew me, I had my bag with me, like barber bag, and I was always on the grind to go. And so that was like the whole freshman year. So he didn't crack the nut that year. And then it was like, got to like sophomore year, I kind of just like doing my own thing. But then even through that, Reed was like always sending me texts and stuff, and I was like, ah, dang, I probably should catch up with him. But I was like, I'm always gonna keep going. So and then it got to my junior year, and then Reed was like, I don't know where he just texted me randomly. He's like, I'm gonna get to know you. He was stuck on us, like he's gonna get to know me. I was like, all right, you can try. But then it's like sitting there, and he just like, one, he also pushed me so hard to join FCA as a small group leader and just like actually lead, because that was something that I was like struggled with because I like never felt worthy of it. And he's like, bro, you're more than capable of it. And he actually pushed me to become a small group leader, and that was like probably one of the best things I could have done. And just leading with the athletes at Clemson, that was another great thing. But really, one of my favorite parts of being in Clemson was, or my time at Clemson was like our, I guess, weekly Bible study for my junior year, senior year. Because it was like kind of like, for me, as a friend to anybody, I'm just like, I might not like, I'm always busy, but I always make time. And Reed was like the epitome of that, especially like his senior year as he was like being leading FCA and like crazy busy all the time, like right before FCA, but he still like take the time to just like go through Hebrews. We chew on Hebrews like for, I think we did it the whole semester, honestly. I was just trying to like go through Hebrews and like just seeing what the Lord was speaking through that passage and through that verse. And but through that, I was just like so happy to just like have a friend like that, because like for me, I really don't open up to that many people. But for Reed to actually like take the time to actually like be like, I want to know you. And I was just like, I don't want to. But I was like, but by the end of it, I was like looking forward every single like Thursday to like hang out with Reed and talk through the Bible and like everything, like playing basketball or just going on a run. He hated running, but he would run for me. Like he would come out and work out with me. So that was like, Reed's like been such an amazing friend, someone I can always call on. Funny story is like, one time I was riding down the street in Clemson, and it was late. It was so late at night, and Reed's like probably dying whenever he hears the story. But like, we're riding down the street, and like, I look over out the window, and like, there's like a giant, like locust-looking creature on my door or in my car, and I was like, oh dear God. So I'm just sitting there looking. I was like, okay, this thing's like, I'm like trying to swat at it while I'm driving, and thing flew down in my car. And I was like, oh my gosh, this thing's in my car. And I was like, who would get this thing? I was like, Alabama, Reed. And I was like, literally got on the phone. I was like, Reed, I'm gonna pull up if you could just get this thing out of my car. And he was like, where are you at? I was like, right down the street, I'll be coming to you. And then like he comes out and literally, no questions asked, opens the door, sticks his head straight up under the thing. He's like, you talking about this thing right here? And just like runs me down. I was like, look, Reed, I would hit you if you weren't like, it had a bug in your hand. But he was just like, that was like kind of showed me, or it really did show me, like Reed was always there for me. Even though I was just like such a tough nut to crack, he was like so willing to be there. And even with Mar, like Mar's like known me for a while. I feel like it was freshman year, I think, when I met Mar. Like Reed randomly called me. I was being there for Reed freshman year, and he just randomly called me and was like, "You mind taking me to the parking lot or something?" I was like, "All right, cool." He was like, "I got a friend though that if you could take me to the car with it." I was like, "Okay." I don't even know if Mar remembers, but like me and Reed driving, then Mar gets in the car, and I was like, "Okay, Reed." I was like, and I was like, he dropped him off or whatever, and I was like, okay, so that's you? He's like, well, yeah, I guess. But Reed and Marv just been like there. I feel like we've done so much stuff. Like we cut the locks off whenever he, like Marv was sitting there just like so amazed with it, and just like Marv's been there, like I feel like through so many like fun moments of me and Reed's relationship. So I just thank Reed so much for the time that he spent with me, even though he didn't have to. And I just thank him for just being an amazing friend. And it let me be in the wedding. He like called me to be like, he's like, I want you to be a groom. And I was like, are you serious? And he's like, yeah. I was like, oh, I've never been in a wedding before. And he's like, oh, you can come. I was like, all right, appreciate it. But yeah, man, it's been a great, great friendship, and I thank Reed so much for everything that he's done. I thank Mar so much for just being amazing friends. The family that invited me to Alabama to spend the time, Roll Tide for a little bit. So yeah, it was great. I just thank y'all so much, and I just wish nothing but the best for your marriage.
All right, we have one more.
Double team. Well, I'm just going to keep it really brief, but I think Mars perfect. And I told Reed this probably 500 times in college. He's heard me say it a lot. But just like you were saying, perfect child, can do no wrong. I like fully believe that about Mar. I don't think she has a flaw. But I got to know Mar in, I think, a pretty unique way. We led on the same Young Life team. So we have some really interesting experiences together through that. But something that I learned through Mar was that she was so selfless and really, really cared about people that oftentimes got overlooked. And she really cared about finding someone that needed her and needed someone in their corner and didn't give up on them no matter how hard they wanted to get away. But I think that was really special. And I also got to see Mar as a leader. She was our team leader. And I think that's a different role than usual for Mar to be up in front of everyone and leading the team. And she's not someone who desires authority or for people to know her and listen to her, which I think is what made her a really great team leader. She was humble and quiet, and the way she led our team is very spirit-led, and you could tell she was so in touch with the Lord, and I think that was a really big gift to all of us and has been a really big gift in our friendship. So I'll say it one more time for good measure. Mar is perfect. You'll never find anyone like her, and you know that, so just don't ever forget that. And I made Katina come up with me, so.
And my heart is beating fast. yes, you did, but I wanted to come and speak. And Mar, I just love you so much. And Reed, y'all's relationship has been so sweet. And I'll never forget when Mar was saying, I would love for you to come to Nick's pub, right? Okay. With me and Reed and some SCA people. And I was like, I don't really know anybody, but it'll be fun. And me and Reed just had a really deep, like everyone's talked about with Reed, they've had these deep conversations about denominations, and it was awesome. I love getting deep about anything like that. So I just, that was the time that I was like, Reed is a keeper, and you do. You just are, you're a deep thinker, and you just are always wanting to grow, and it's really cool to see. But Mar, I just want to mention, we were Pi Chi's together in college, and that's where we met, and Emma Simmons, who is not here, she'll be here later, but she was the one who said before Pi Chi, she was like, you need to meet Mar, she's the best person ever, I just feel like y'all are gonna connect so quickly. And she actually sat in front of me at our training before all Pi Chi started. And we started talking, I was like, Emma told me about you, whatever, and we started talking, and that led to a very quick, deep friendship. And just getting to see you lead your girl group and just pour into them helped me want to pour into my girls better. And we had walks every morning there, and we would get each other up and motivate each other to pour into the girls day in and day out. But I just want to say marriage is such a sweet thing, and got to experience it for about six-ish months, and becoming one is amazing. I think the freedom comes when it is sacrificial love and truly just putting the other before the putting the one, you know what I'm trying to say. I cannot say that right now. And just always putting God first, and in love and freedom will follow. So I love y'all.
Okay, anyone else? Floor's still open. All right. Okay, so whoever's handling the video, if y'all could work that piece of it, and then I'm going to try to get some help moving this mic to the side. I guess we'll leave the lights like this. Is that the plan? Okay. And we got a short video we want to show, and then that will conclude our evening, and y'all can go watch a football game. Okay. Thank you.
friend again?